This is part two of a collaboration between Fraser Cain and myself on the subject of planetary migration, covering both its implications in the past but also the future, both in nature and what we as an advanced civilization could do with artificial migration. You can watch part one on Fraser's channel, link below, or through the end screen of this video. As Fraser discussed in part 1, planetary migration has had profound effects on our solar system, ultimately leading to the arrangement we have now. In turn, that planetary dance allowed Earth to be what it is, and allow for life to arise. But it also affects many other systems in the universe, and favor or disfavor their chances for life. This could allow for situations where a star in its younger phases is too active to allow for life to arise within its habitable zone. But as it calms down, should a planet migrate inward, the equations could change, meaning that the conditions for life might be favored in certain circumstances, such as with the red dwarf stars, but it will also continue to affect our solar system long into its future. Future migration, whether natural or artificial, may someday affect the outcome of life on Earth if it's still present, and may even make other places in our solar system habitable, such as Saturn's moon Titan, which is thought could someday form surface oceans as the sun swells into a red giant. While we sometimes see planetary migration in terms of the past, in our solar system it's never really stopped. It just moves very slowly, but in geologic timescales it is still quite evident. For example, Pluto. While it is in a stable orbital resonance with Neptune, its position evolves, and after about 10 million years from now, it becomes increasingly difficult to accurately predict Pluto's orbital position. This chaos gets worse the longer you go. Some planets may evolve into more elliptical orbits over time, which may present some problems should the human race still be around billions of years from now. One is that Mars's orbit may eventually evolve to cross Earth's, which is just asking for a planetary collision. This has happened before. The formation of our moon is thought to have been the result of a collision with a Mars-sized object. Another related issue is a bit closer in time. Within a billion years, Mercury's migration may bring it into close enough proximity to Venus that it may get ejected out of the solar system entirely. But it's also possible, though the chances here are exceedingly low, that Mercury might slam into Venus or be hurled in our direction, making for a second way our planet might someday get smacked again by a planetary object. One wonders if we'll end up with a second moon out of it. But ultimately, none of this is very predictable. These are based on truly massive timescales with huge amounts of uncertainty. But one thing is certain, and you can take this one to the bank. Our sun has a limited life in the form that it currently is, and it will change over time. As the sun ages, it will change in both size and mass. As far as size, it will someday swell into a red giant star, greatly altering the gravitational balance of the solar system. But at the same time, the sun loses mass over time, further altering the gravitational equation and the balance of the solar system. Solar mass loss occurs in two ways. The first comes from nuclear fusion. The second is the solar wind. Particles constantly stream off the surface of the sun into space to a combined tune of about 5.5 tons per second. Over time, this loss changes the sun's gravitational field, causing the planets to alter their orbits. This has already created an issue for astronomers. Originally, an astronomical unit within astronomy was equivalent to the distance between the Earth and the Sun, about 93 million miles. In time, this has changed, albeit very slightly, and now Earth is just a bit over 1 AU from the Sun, thereby making the astronomical unit an arbitrary way of measuring distance. Migration also has implications on another unit in astronomy, the solar mass, which used to be the mass of the Sun, but not anymore. These two units will increasingly become detached from what was originally their basis. The net effect of all of this is that as the sun ages, there is a small chance that, like Mercury, Earth too could get gravitationally ejected from the solar system. If this were to occur, could life survive? The answer really depends on what kind of life and what that life is doing. For example, humans could well alter the equation if we're still around, and by that time a class 2 or 3 civilization on the Kardashev scale. Barring that, as the sun's luminosity increases well before it reaches the red giant phase, it will still have long ago stripped Earth of most of its surface life, but probably not completely. Microbial life is extraordinarily resilient and may well survive that phase of the sun's life, only finally succumbing when and if the sun engulfs Earth. but needless to say, anything left alive on planet Earth during an ejection would need to be really tough and would need to be able to make use of geothermal energy such as ocean vents. These vents should persist even out in deep space, keeping pockets of water in liquid form which could hypothetically sustain ecosystems of some sort, if only microbial. How long could this state of affairs persist? The answer is a very long time. The Earth's core contains decaying radioactive elements, and in fact, there are sufficient amounts of these to guarantee geothermal heat on this planet far longer than it will take the sun to reach its red giant phase. Long half-life isotopes like thorium-232 will guarantee tens of billions of years of geothermal energy for this planet should it get kicked out into deep space. But Earth's surface would quickly freeze under these conditions, for a time, but over a very long period of time, Earth might acquire a thick hydrogen envelope as it travels across deep space. Coupled with the geothermal heat, this might eventually provide a warm enough surface where liquid water flows again. Perhaps the life that once existed in those oceanic pockets could once again colonize the planet and evolve, but it would no doubt take a completely different path than it did earlier in the planet's history. For one, there would be no sun, and that changes everything. Plus, the thickness of the atmosphere would mean no stars would be visible to any complex life that might develop. Life on Earth solves this darkness problem in several ways, including no functioning eyes at all, such as blind fish living in caves. Or it might solve it through bioluminescence, as happens in our oceans. Trouble is, if this new life eventually develops a civilization, that civilization might have no idea that there was an entire universe out there to explore. Or, alternatively, we may still be around in one form or another, but still lack any ability to prevent our ejection. This allows for the possibility of a technologically altered rogue planet Earth, where the planet is artificially kept habitable. Another take might be that we intentionally migrate the Earth to be located further from the sun as it ages, and reorder the real estate in our solar system to however we see fit. This goes for any other planets in the solar system. We know that there may well be planets beyond the orbit of Neptune. Indeed, there is mounting circumstantial evidence for this. What if we found an Earth-sized planet out there? Might we migrate it inward for use as a second world after terraforming? But just how do you move a planet? The answer would be complicated and depend on the situation of what it was you wanted to move. But to migrate Earth further out from the sun, a strategy to do just that was put forth in a paper by D.G. Korycansky and colleagues, link in the description below. The concept involves using rockets to manipulate an asteroid into an orbit that encounters both Earth and Jupiter. Over time, the transfer of energy from this object would cause Earth to move outward. The researchers conclude that to maintain our position within the sun's changing habitable zone, such an object passing Earth every 6,000 years would gradually do the trick, along with other planetary encounters over a very long period of time until we've survived the sun's red giant phase. The authors note that this would be extraordinarily dangerous, since when you go moving orbits, you would need to have a really good asteroid map to ensure that you don't hit anything. But then again, if your sun is going to kill you anyway, you've got nothing to lose. After the red giant phase, we would need to look to migrating the planet back towards the sun as a white dwarf, or simply abandon Earth altogether in favor of building habitats close in and harvesting what energy we can from the white dwarf. What's notable about this plan is how startlingly easy it is compared to interstellar space travel. This is already, hypothetically speaking, within our technological grasp to move an asteroid in this fashion. Obviously, we have thousands of years to consider this option, but the point is that we could maintain a presence in this solar system long past the sun's red giant phase, and live on our migrating planet for tens of billions of years, potentially easier than we could if we colonized a new solar system. And within all of this lies a SETI can of worms. If an alien civilization were looking at our solar system long term while we orchestrated migration, as in billions of years, what would they see? They would see a habitable world that just happens to be migrating outward along with a habitable zone of its star, orchestrated in such a way to have planetary encounters to support this process. At some point, that looks really unnatural and planned, making this a potential SETI technosignature. If you see star systems with planets with very unlikely migrations going on, you may well have found a civilization doing the only thing it can to avoid destruction by its changing star, migration. Thanks for listening. This has been a collaboration with Fraser Cain, publisher of Universe Today and one of the best astronomy channels on YouTube, and we hope you enjoyed it. And be sure to check out part one, link below and in the end screen. And be sure to like, comment, and subscribe to our channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.